Hello to all our very beautiful viewers within and across Sierra Leone, and a pleasant welcome to your favorite TV magazine show, Wetin Now, the basic info.
You already know. Today we're coming to you live on Sunday, 23rd October, here at the AfriCell headquarters at Wilberforce. And this is a special edition.
Very special.
And we're
indeed.
A comfort zone.
Very,
just
very
imagine.
Comfortable. Just look,
just
at, the
look at the scenery. Just
very
look at
colorful.
The background. Everything,
you know,
is
with the
beautiful.
Orange and the purple. Yeah. It seems to be very, very nice. Yeah. Of course, you know, this is Wetin Now, the show that gives you all in news, entertainment, stories, and many more. We are here to give you all week. Of course, it's the basic info. And you deserve to have Wetin Now on your TV set. So do not touch that remote, because we're going to give you a very, very exciting ride for the next hour. So you stay with us. And Arimah, yes.
Why are you looking at me like that?
I'm just like, I don't know what to say.
Okay. Just tell me I look good. Just tell me you like my dress.
Oh, you want me
but
to say
you're not
like
a lady. You're not a lady, so I can't give you my dress, you know.
Oh, maybe I can give it to my sister.
Okay, you have to pay for that, you know.
Never mind.
Okay, now we have the headlines. Today, we have child labor, which has been a trending issue in our country.
Of course, if you are not part of the first event organized by Masterpiece as the Nelson Award, then we'll tell you what you missed in that event.
And also, we have for you Music for Girls. As you know, the CEO for Music for Girls, Miss Esther Michael Emme, had partnered with Plan International, and they had the Face of Plan to commemorate Universal Girl Child Day. And so you will see girls, you know, strutting their stuff, showing
yes,
their talents,
exactly.
And everything.
And I was part of the event. It was really, really glamorous.
Why did anybody not tell me? You know, I should have won that Face of Plan International if I was told.
Really?
Yes.
But only
I have 100%. You know,
no, never say never. So
I know.
I'm definitely, you know, have confidence in you. So I know you can do it better than even most of the people. But
kudos to her,
to
Onike,
yes,
and to the runners up,
yes.
Alima,
and one,
our own very
Wetin
own
Now, yes,
Wetin Now reporter,
she's,
Hannah Yangsin.
Yes,
kudos,
cool.
Girl.
And please, guys, do not forget, for those of you who know of the nomination, that is the Africa Entertainment Legends Award. Voting is still in progress. I have been nominated for On-Air Personality of the Year. Please go to Google and type AALA Awards as one word and vote as many times as you can. Voting is once in every 24 hours. And of course, you can vote with as many machines. You have an iPad, you have a computer, different stuff. So you could vote. And please don't forget, for the other Sierra Leoneans as well, sign up Sharif, Mohamed, Janet, Philippa Nahas, and Morris. Please do that and show love to your country, Sierra Leone.
And also in this segment, we have True Talk and Pikin Waka Board.
Pikin Waka
all side. You're not going to leave me.
And something very special. So just stay tuned. And you're definitely not going to regret watching the show today.
And viewers, don't forget to like our Facebook page, Facebook.com/WetinNow, and leave your comments.
Yes.
I know you guys love this show.
So, yes, maybe have your suggestions or whatever you want.
Yeah.
Just leave them there, and definitely we'll definitely give you what you need. It's Wetin Now, the basic info. Let's go for a short break. We'll be right back.
Follow the action. The AfriCell Live Score Service, bringing you all the latest sports update, goal replay and sports news of the Champions League, Premier League, Italian League, Spanish League, German League and French League matches to your fingertips. To receive match updates, sport news or goal replay about your team, match or league, just dial *707#. For more info, call 111.
AfriCell, now we network.
Lovely viewers to your favorite TV magazine show. We are your presenters, Arimah Bangora.
I'm yours truly, Eric Kawa. And of course, today, Arimah, we've got a big surprise for our wonderful viewers.
Yeah, and I was like excited, so excited.
I was super
because
excited.
Because this person is a household name in entrepreneurship.
Yes, and it's been a long time we've been expecting him in the studio.
Yeah.
And definitely, it just comes as a blessing in disguise.
He's, just imagine being the CEO of four companies.
That's
who
really
does
great.
That?
Really, really great.
And he's a motivational speaker,
yes.
An inspiration
and also
to all.
Did you know that he's a pastor?
Did I don't think I know he's a pastor.
Okay, when he comes, maybe he will clear the air.
Okay. And one of his favorite quotes that I can I quote from him.
Yeah.
He says, you don't live your life by chance, but you live your life by design.
Yes, and the other one says that the story of the African child remains the same, but from nothing, you can be something. I know by now the audience might be knowing, who we're talking about. So ladies and gentlemen, please help us welcome our guest, as this man has over the years roused the crowd with his very motivational speech. And when he talks, no matter what mood you are in, you definitely be all right. Ladies and gentlemen, our very dear viewers, please help us show some love to Mr. Joe Abbas Bangura, Corporate Affairs Officer for Africell and TV host for Life by Design. Ladies, show some love.
Thank you very
Welcome
much.
So much sir.
Thank you, Eric.
Nice
Thank
having you.
Sir. Thank you, Arimah.
Nice
Thank you.
Having you with us
Thank
today.
You.
Welcome.
Thank you for having me.
It's been quite a long time. We've actually been longing to get you in our studios, and it's a pleasure to have you.
It's a pleasure to be here, and I love young people. I was once a young man, and I have a lot of ideas, and I've actually been through the stages. So I know what it feels like to be young, and all the struggles that comes along with that. So it's really a pleasure to be here.
I mostly watch your programs on TV, and I usually wave. I don't know if you have ever seen.
No, unfortunately, I hear about that all the time. Okay. People tell me I wave, but unfortunately,
there's
only one way.
Waving.
I could only, you could only see me. I cannot see you at all.
Yeah. Okay, yes. It's a pleasure to have you, sir.
It's a pleasure. It's my pleasure.
First of all, let's start the conversation. I mean, you're always quoted in quotes and officially.
Who wouldn't dress officially when they're on TV?
Well, maybe that's the answer. That's the answer.
Okay.
Actually, it's most of what I do and the places I go would require, as part of protocol, to be able to be dressed in certain ways.
Okay.
So possibly that's why most times, even when I'm not on TV, I would have a sports jacket on as a minimum.
Okay.
And it's just basically the environment that I operate in.
That's great.
If I were an engineer and I'm going to a factory, that would be different.
Okay, so let's start the conversation with your childhood. First of all, tell us, how was it like for you when you were a child?
Well, I'm sure it's no story any longer. It's no secret any longer, because I've talked about this all the time.
Okay.
And in the stories I've shared, you said something just now about the story of the African child. It's always the same.
Yes.
But from nothing,
we can be something.
So obviously, the story I have been out, I was born at 18 Taylor Street, Kisi, just at the back of where you have that Sun Motor Company. Our house was just at the back there. And then if you look at the video that was done by Africell, the heroes, our everyday heroes, the house there, the building there, the house there, and the corrugated zinc pan body house there, I was actually born. I was actually born.
You're usually wondering whether it's a true life story. I mean, or
yes,
something
because
just...
it's
a true life story.
Like
the kid was not, the kid was only used, we only used the kid to recreate
the
story.
The old people were there,
and then they were, you know, they are not the original, but at the end, the people at the end were actually my parents. They were my mom and my dad.
The ones you hugged.
Yes, the ones I hugged at the end, they were real my mom, my real mom and dad in Wellington. But then, you know, I grew up I was born in Kisi. At age 8, we moved to Wellington.
Okay.
So it was Kisi Primary School and then Wellington Primary School.
Wow.
You had to have somewhere we call Dong School, Middle School, Up School, Class 7.
Wow.
Then start for the Albert Academy. And in 1979, that's when I entered the Albert Academy.
So, talking about school, how was it? How did you cope with school and everything? Did you see yourself being the entrepreneur you are today?
Well, you know, coming up, people have a lot of dreams.
Yeah.
And but actually, the most important point here is coming from the family background that I came from. Maybe basically there's not much you could expect, because both my parents were illiterate. We were born in Wellington. Wellington was like a village. And so it's almost like there's a level that's set, there's a ceiling that, you know, this is the level everybody reaches and nobody crosses this level. So whatever dreams I have, I'm sure at that point in time when I was in primary school, wasn't much that you could say it is something that you would, like I would say I would be a president. If I would say it, maybe it's just joking amongst my colleagues, but I never knew I could be what I am now in a true sense.
Okay, kids, you happen to be the managing 4 businesses in Sierra Leone. And I remember we were having a conversation the day before, yesterday, And then you were telling us about a man managing 300 companies. I was wondering, what's the magic behind you being able to manage four companies
and of course
the
one
in 300 companies?
Yes, and this is a very important point young people have to learn.
Yeah.
School teaches you how to learn.
Yeah.
80% of what I know now, I didn't learn in school. So our ability to know that I can be able to learn whatever I want to learn, the information is out there. Okay. You have to know what you want to know and how to find it. And the most important tool that we have to fight poverty and illiteracy is the internet. Mm-hmm. Whether it's YouTube and Google, there are lots and lots of information that is there. So. Yeah. You know, so when you joined me, what I was watching or listening to was the story of Richard Branson. Richard Branson has run over 300 companies in the UK and around the world, from multimedia to airlines to fitness centers at the highest level, hotels and all of kind of things. How was he able to do it? There's a story behind it. So success leaves clues. You only have to read their stories and find out how. But there's a way to do it. If they've done it, it wasn't magic. There's a systematic process to achieve whatever I want to achieve in life. And once I learned that, I'm never in doubt. Okay. You know, currently, amongst everything I do, Chief Corporate Affairs Officer, AFRISEL. And you wouldn't imagine how much of those skills I actually learned as part of my relationship with AFRISEL. Yeah. AFRISEL started from nowhere. When we had the first 50,000 subscribers in the country, I was the chief financial officer of the company. And so I sent a text message to the managing director then to say, congratulations, boss, we've just reached 50,000 subscribers. And he sent back a message, yeah, congratulations, Joe, we started the match for 100,000. Now we have over 3 million subscribers. It's a huge company.
That's great.
It's a huge company. We scattered all over the country. And so AFRISEL was in itself a university, is in itself a university for me, in terms of what I've learned to be able to take those skills of what it takes to take a small business like that and grow it so big. And so learning every day, just open your eyes, learn how to do things is what has brought me to this level. Learning every day. Whatever you want to do, whether it's mathematics, it's geography, it's English, it's economics, whatever you're struggling with in school, there's an answer to it. You have to just find the answers in your colleagues, in books, on the internet, on YouTube, on Google. Cut the number of hours you spend on Facebook. It doesn't help a lot.
Exactly.
So it's very fundamental. Don't be intimidated by anything. Don't be intimidated by what you don't know. You could always learn what you don't know. And so that's the frame of mind you have to have. I can learn. If I don't know it, I can learn it.
That's a slogan.
It's in books.
If I don't know it,
I can learn it. I can learn about it. So it's in books, on the internet, on YouTube, on Google. The same time we're spending on Facebook, we could just switch. You know, I was talking to somebody yesterday and he used the word antipathy. And let me give you an example. I was in a meeting yesterday. Somebody used the word antipathy. Now, based on my experience, the word we could normally tell you, give you an idea of what it means.
Yes.
I know pathy is sympathy and all of the kind of things. So yeah. Antipathy, I know, is something against. That is against.
Yes.
So in my mind, I said this is against sympathy. Yeah. So it's somebody not being sympathetic. I know. But we were talking, went to my computer, my iPad, and just went to Google and clicked antipathy. And I saw it. It's just confirmed. So I learn on the go. So it's that attitude we must have as young people. Running 300 companies, running four or five companies. Like I said, maybe in the next 5 years, I'll be running 20 companies in this country.
Wow.
But all it will take is just learn from those who've done it.
And something we discussed earlier, and that really touched me. You were telling me about 10% of someone's talent is just an amount. Like if you can sing, it's just 10% of the singing. But it has to do with your character.
Of music, yeah. 10% of music.
Yes. Well, then the rest has to do with the character and how you comport yourself.
It's a package. And you, at a very early age, it's a great opportunity you have to be good broadcasters, people who would appear on television. It's a great opportunity. I wish I had the opportunity when I was as young as you. But what I said was that knowing how to sing is 10% of being a musician. And you could take that, extrapolate it to any game. Knowing how to play a football, it's just 10-20% of being what it takes to be a successful footballer.
Yeah.
You've had people who've just been, if you could quote names, there are players that come out from Africa, go to the Premier League, played for 1 year. Diouf was an example.
Yeah.
Elijah, he did so beautiful well in the African Nations Cup, went to the World Cup, did so beautiful well. He came to the Premiership, he couldn't handle himself very well. He spat in the face of another player. Attitude. So that's why I said it takes a whole lot more. In addition to the technical skills, there's a packaging that you have to put together. So a musician does not only know how to sing, your broad knowledge about philosophy, psychology, the people around you, economics, government, can they read beyond where they left off in school? Because school only teaches you how to learn. And so, because the broader the perspective that the musician has, the richer what they do, the richer it is what will become. So knowing how to sing is just 10% of being a musician. You have to be able to now grow all of those things. You grow the reach of your vocabulary, your practicing oratory, knowing how to communicate, how to speak, your grammar. And, a lot of time you hear musicians say, I'm a musician.
Yes.
And they say it all the time, musician. But somebody should be able to say, no, the C is silent, it runs to its musician. It's not musician. And so, so it's all of those things. So you have to be able to be a very successful musician. You have to be able to put all of those together, learn, read, add, study government, study economics, study everything. What is inflation? What is this? Broaden your knowledge. It enriches. Then it talks about character issue that you have to have. Because, like I said, you have people who are so talented, but you've seen them behave one way and you don't want to do anything with them. So they'll only be successful for a short period of time because they are not rounded.
Earlier on, you mentioned that during crisis, new leaders emerge, and then leaders that are weak crumble, and then what's the word again? And
leaders that are strong.
So how do you manage crisis, especially with four companies? Because it's very rare to see someone at your age have four companies. Like, you have to work till you're like middle age or maybe really old.
I know. So how do you manage crisis? Is learn how to manage crisis. The strongest leaders, what I said was, if you complete that during crisis, weak leaders crumble, good leaders excel, and the new leaders emerge. People step up. They weren't leaders, but the way they handled what was happening, they automatically, people saw the gift in them and said, this guy is a leadership material. And so, there are ways you handle crisis. You have to study how to handle crisis. You have to be calm. You have to be resourceful. You have to be creative. You have to be resourceful. When things have gone wrong, that's not the point you begin to shout and to look for who to blame. Now, who did I do this? Who caused this? Who made this happen? Yeah. No, that's not the time. You're looking for a solution. How do we fix it? It says, close the door, fix it before you come back to now begin to find out what happened, who caused it, what made it happen. So there are several things you could do in a crisis moment, and one of them is not to panic and a lot of the things, but it's something you have to learn. But as I said, I could say it again. In crisis moments, that's when you need leadership. Nobody needs a leader or needs leadership, requires leadership if everything is okay, if everything is smooth, there's no traffic, there's no inflation, there's nothing. Nobody needs it. Nobody even knows that the leader is around. It's when crisis steps in, when you have a huge crisis, then people begin to look for a leader, begin to look for the leaders in their community, a leader in the classroom, not just a leader in the political arena, a leader in the office. It's really in moments of crisis. When there's a tough nut to be cracked, nobody knows what to do. That's when leaders have to step in.
Okay, before we go to our very first news item, I have a question. We were discussing earlier, and I said you're also a pastor. So tell us, being in the spiritual world, and at the same
actually, I'm planning to do a biography that looks at all the segments of my life. My professional life as a businessman, my life in the media, my life as a father. Well, it could be an autobiography, but okay. I'm planning on something big because I will soon be celebrating my 50th birthday.
Wow. I hope we're invited.
Golden Jubilee, right?
What?
A Golden Jubilee.
Well, yes. So it's a wonderful time to be able to now just look back as a puny boy. That's why I said I believe in young people. I believe in anybody. I believe in the power of people to transform their lives because I've been through it. Like they said, I've gone there and I've had it all. So, but yes, I'm a pastor. I went to theological college. I studied for my pastoral studies and qualified at the Evangelical College of Theology. And I'm a pastor at Winner Chapel International, pastoral assistant. And as a matter of fact, I preach very regularly in church on Sundays.
I'm mostly tempted to ask whether you are an art student.
No, and it's a very interesting question, because what I thought, you know, looking back, I am much of an artistic person than an analytical person. Okay. So I'm much more creative. You know, I'm right brain. So I like to talk about creative stuff. I'm very, very strong with my linguistic skills. And wow. I don't study linguistics in school, but I'm very much more studied and astute in my linguistic part of me, which is the right side of my brain, creative thinking and all of those things, than I would my figures. So the fact is that, and it's difficult for people to believe, because I'm a chartered accountant, and a chartered accountant would be somebody who would have mastered figures. So I'm comfortable with figures, but not as much as I'm comfortable with my language and linguistic skills. So, so you know, you put all of those together, like I said, I think I shared with you, life and abilities. You're telling me you wanted to do six things at the same time. You wanted to do fashion designing, you wanted international law and everything. And so what I said to you was, you don't have to have certificates for all the things you want to do in life.
Yes.
You don't have to. I don't have a certificate in journalism. I don't have a certificate. So you don't have to have a certificate for all of the things you want to do in life. Life is, you go on in life, it's like a toolbox. Like a carpenter goes around with a toolbox, he has a hammer, he has a saw, he has a plane, he has a tape rule, and all of those kind of things. And when you go through life, you meet with different challenges, and each one requires a different tool. So what you should be focused on in life is developing your ability to fix this kind of tools. So I go somewhere, it's a spiritual problem, I put my pastor cap on, and I say, let us pray together. And you go somewhere, it's an accounting issue, and so we say, let's talk about the double entry. The debit goes to the bank, the credit should have been here, it's not, so this is the error. Then you move there, and you go, so journalism, and whether it's change behavioral change, like we do on Life by Design, how do we get people to change the way they're thinking? I come to AfriCell, and all the jobs that I do, and I do there in AfriCell, it's like tools in a toolbox which I represent, and it depends on the problem that I have to solve. That's what depends the tool that I take out.
Indeed, as I told you earlier, when he talks, he actually rouses the crowd. So for now, we're just going to keep a hold on to him. The conversation is getting very interesting, but we'll come back later, and we're going to take our very first news item. Yes, Arimah.
We have, on our first news item, we have child labor, which has been one of the most disturbing things in our country today. We see children being given, you know, things to do. In one instance, I saw a woman giving a child a tray of groundnut, really, really heaped up. Wow. And then the child has to sell that thing. I was going to school only. And I stopped and I asked the child, do you go to school? And then the child says, no. My auntie says that I should sell. If I don't sell, she will not pay my school.
And mostly you find out that they're not with their biological parents,
yes.
Either with their aunt or
And she told
their
me she was from the provinces.
From the provinces. That's
mostly
what
that's what happens. So,
yes. So
really,
let's look at this video as one of our reporters, Mustafa Dauda, visited the site where this child labor issue is really happening. Watch out.
Child labor is still a common practice in communities here in Sierra Leone, despite governments and NGOs' efforts to stop the practice. Child labor is mostly common in homes, and interestingly, most parents do not see this as a crime. They do not only support this, but have skillfully succeeded in making kids and communities see the practice as a normal way of life. We take you through.
My name is Usman Conte. Me and our old 13, Dadego Amid Principal Primary School. But she make a big for Brookstone because my people don't get money for pay for me school fee, for do all that thing back, for bye-bye for meeting there.
My name is Mustafa Kano, 15 years old. I do go over from the RC. We go home to Pano, yes. I make a diaper. Then, what a diaper? In the pay for me school fees. And for that a diaper, for this school care.
My name is Kajatu Konti, I live in Madia, Muslim school, primary. I don't know how to get any kind of doctor.
My name is Arimah Sayeden. I live in Antidon Primary School. I am from 2 million. Then, I am 15. This is a good one because I meet my father. for not for the meet and they will not for the new disco care. And we saw Papa Day, we only left our own ticket to go pass. So now I make better disco care. We saw for any self for the meet up a pizza and I'll bet for Dongo, not for Dongana. So now I make the disco.
This is it. How many homes are still carrying on the practice? You and I know too well. How ready are we to stop or minimize the practice? You and I know too well. This is Waiting Now on AYV Television, Freetown, Sierra Leone. Mustafa Karim Dauda reporting.
Many thanks indeed to our reporter there, Mustafa Dauda, for that comprehensive report on issues of child labor. You're still on Waiting Now, and it is a very special episode for today. We have with us our guest, who is Mr. Pastor Joe Abbas Bangura in the studio.
Why did you put the pastor in front of the Mr.?
Mr. Abbas Bangura. And we'll soon add professor to the title.
Well, I
don't
know.
Doctor?
They call me doctor. People call me doctor all the time. They say Dr. Joe Abbas Bangura. They call me all kinds of names. But it's really, now, even so, when I call myself, I don't even intend to mention my titles because, you know, I don't even say pastor because, you know, I believe it's actually life. It's not in what you're called.
Yeah.
It's just a name. It's in what you can deliver. And so people carry a lot of titles and they don't deliver what the title says. They carry. And so, but they would put, you have to call me by my title. But anyway, it's required. Protocols required sometimes, all the time, that you call people by titles where they're required. But I'm not actually fussy. It's in actually what I can deliver at the end of the day. That's the value I give to life. It's not my title.
Most people, when they talk about you, Mr. Joe Abbas Bangura, you're always related to Kelvin Doe.
Right.
Always. I don't know if you have another person that you have helped, but most people, as soon as you call Kelvin Doe, you have been related, you have been linked up with Kelvin Doe because you were the first person who showcased his talent, yes, what he could do, and you helped him.
Mm-hmm.
And so do you intend to help other people? And if other people have such creative abilities to help society, are you coming to help them? How should they meet you? How should they approach you? Because some people will want to come.
I know.
But I don't know, there's this bridge.
That would be a big barrier. And you're right. So Kelvin Doe. Now, possibly I think what's been happening is I'm naturally positioned given what I went through in life. I could not have been where I am now had it not been for people who believed on me, stepped in, helped me when I couldn't help myself.
Yeah.
When I went to school, failed my O-levels, dropped out of school, all of those is gone, all of those is true. I would see my friends that were in school together, I'd hide from them, it was true. And all of those things. So somebody stepped into my life, a mentor, a pastor, made me realize that there's much more in my life. I hadn't just become what I'd become because my parents were illiterate. I have made some stupid choices that have also landed me there. I said, if you change those choices, you couldn't change your parents. You don't have to change your parents. But if you change your choices, you could change your life. And so I started making, you know, new choices. So his intervention in my life, I can remember at some point in time, I went to my parents and said, he said, Pa Abu, these sons of yours will talk to nations. These kids of yours will talk to nations. And that was a prophecy. Yeah, because that's what I'm doing. I was talking about myself and my elder brother. So apparently, and not just apparently, I think this is what I planted in my DNA, the desire to be able to help young people. So somebody helped me, I have to be able to pay back into life. So when Kelvin Doe came up, somebody gave me a phone call from the SLBC, and they said, somebody appeared on television last night that we think you need to meet. He's a very young boy, this is what he's done. I got a telephone number. I got Musa, one of the staff then at SLBC, and took us all the way up to Dwaza. We located this young man, brought him to the office. We spent thousands, millions to be able to organize what he had then built. We did an award ceremony, took him to British Council, showcased him, moved him from there. He used to stay with one of my staff, and he actually stayed with one of my staff for almost a year at home. So got him back to Albert Academy, and fees that were supposed to be paid, taking care of him on a regular basis. So until you know, we got him across America with David Senge of Innovate Sierra Leone.
Okay.
And they said the rest is history. The video that was done on him is now over 10 million, has had over 10 million views on YouTube.
Yeah.
And so, you know, it's a pleasure that we had to be able to contribute to one more person so that, like, I keep quoting Reverend Bobson, so maybe Kelvin will continue to quote and said, it was this man, Maybe I've paid back into life. I don't know if that's enough. But now, has there been another person? Yes. The other young man, which I think I've appeared with television a couple of times, is Saltin Masali. Saltin sent me an email 2013. He was 23 years of age to say he was this, he had this skills, self-taught himself computer programming, and he needed help. And he sent me the link of the website he designed and a couple of things he'd done. Sent him back a reply in 1 hour. I saw him the next morning, and we were able to build a huge business around him. It's huge. The business recently won an award in the UK. And the business has been valued recently over $1 million.
Wow.
That's what the business has been valued.
That's
so
huge.
Salty now employs about 15 other young people. Wow. Young people creating jobs for young people. And most of them are older than him. But it's been a beautiful journey.
It could be that it's more on people that are doing technological innovative things.
Oh yeah, I see what you're now saying. So because Kelvin is in the area of technology and innovation and so forth. No, that's not the case. Okay. Now there are a couple of things you have to be able to do in life. Okay. And by the way, I could doff my hat to Saltin. When he sent me an email, even in the way he sent the email, he carved it in such a way that from the subject of the email, it could catch my attention.
Wow.
So there are lots of things you have to learn. I'm a very, very busy man, as you'd imagine. I'm very, very busy. To be able to put your family, and I serve on the boards of 3 and 4 major organizations in the country, golf club, Chamber of Commerce, Institute of Chartered Accountants, Sierra Leone, National Youth Commission, wow. World Vision. And so you serve on those boards. In addition to all of these things I do, very, very busy. So how do you position yourself so that you could catch attention? People's attention, who are very, very busy. It's a skill you have to be able to master. So it's not just them, but it's open to everybody. Keep pushing. We have the Life by Design contact, 030-600-600. Try your best. WhatsApp, send email info@lifebydesign.sl. Because you know what? If you're diligent enough, you would catch somebody's attention that you need to catch. Whose attention into that? You need to be insistent, you need to persevere, you need to push again and again, you need to make it easier, you need to position yourself. But so actually, the stuff is that it's not that you don't want to see people, but you have so much on your plate to do,
okay.
And you're running the number of companies you're running, so much responsibilities that you don't have the time.
Okay.
If you want to be able to catch somebody's attention, you have to position yourself to be able to do that, and that could take another show as to how you could do that systematically. Like Saltin, what I said he did, even in the email he sent, the way he carved the subject, I wouldn't say in the subject now, so somebody doesn't use the same approach, but the way he catched the subject was, he couched the subject so that when I received that email, I would know it is somebody I need to talk to. So to the point, know that this person is busy, how can I capture their attention? Somebody sent me a manuscript the other day that they wanted me to review or to support, but the guy was so pushy. He was making it as if I was obligated to help him. And there's a line between being perseverance and being pushy, and between, you move to the extent where you become a pest.
Wow.
You become a pest, and so that's not what you want to be.
Yeah.
So, but there are a lot of things you could be able to do. But yeah, the reason why I don't see a lot of people because I'm limited in what I can do.
Okay.
But I want to be able to help a lot more people. Mm-hmm. And what I'm doing is to be able to institutionalize the process so that I don't have to be directly involved.
Okay.
But there will be ways to be able to help these people and through the institutions we set up and make it.
Now go for a short music break. And this music break is for you, the music especially.
It's for me.
Yeah, because
we're talking about motivation.
Growth.
Right. Okay.
Now specifically, it's about agriculture.
Okay.
In a literary form, let's say in a symbolic way, it is trying to talk about motivation, trying to do more.
Because from beans,
cocoa.
And from cocoa, you have chocolate. So from you, we had to see Kelvin.
Okay,
Doe,
you work
we
on
had
yourself.
To see everyone
so possibly what's
else,
also saying is you have to just work on yourself.
Yeah.
And life never gives people food. People walk around life and they look for food, but life never gives food. Life gives you seed. And you grow the seed from one level to the other. Like you said, from the seed, you have the beans. From the beans, you have the cocoa. So let's have it. Let's roll
so
it on.
So it's coconut chocolate. And of course, it's lots of African countries, lots of African artists coming together doing the song. Watch it out. And we sure you definitely enjoy it. Go nowhere.
Huh. that you want to go. I will surely take you to any food that you want to eat. I will surely go with you, baby, just be confident. Take you all around the continent. You can choose anywhere that you want to end. You can eat any dish, it's a continent.
I'm gonna put my future in the name. Gonna make everybody understand. Right now, it's time to make a change. We stand together.
Jeunesse africaine qui tu vends nos terres. Maratana Congo, wow, wow.
Let us grow, grow, grow together. Plant the seeds of life forever. Let the earth provide for your children's a hundred never.
So let us grow, grow, grow Africa. Make we join hands, build Africa. The time is now, the land is green. All that's left is you and me.
The world, Pichiche music is back, 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 back.
Natamani ingejua kitambo. Kama ukulima ndiyo mpango. Ningesha kuwa bali, lakini afadhali. Mwanoni mezinduka na anza isafari. Pata abari, kilimo sasa ndo ujanja. Cheki watu navyotoka maisha, wanajenga skia. Hii, siya bidi, lima na lipa. Ongeza bidi kwenye kilima zibufisa.
Moyo wetu rengeju, rengeju. Mahibi singe mbubi, singe mbe.
Lansa sementi na terra kuishada na mamba.
When all of them are singing, Ewa na binso, binso, Ewa choco na chocolate, na chocolate. Then they have one for when they're going, Osi, going down. Wow. No, I like the song. I hope you enjoy the song.
Well, yeah, it's a beautiful song, and not just for the music itself, but also what it's pushing, the message it's sending. Because, you know, I know in the last several years, even as a nation, Sierra Leone, we've been talking about how much we need to be able to be self-sustaining ourselves in food.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, we're still not at the position where we could do that. If you look at the graph of what we're spending to import just rice, which is our staple food in the country, the graph goes this way, which means it's rising all the time. Somebody was saying, I think maybe it's about $3 million a week. If you put it together, that's what we're spending on importing rice. And if you turn that around and spend it locally in the economy, instead of importing $3 million rice a week, and set up companies. If you take even $50 million and invest in companies, and says, and they'll grow in the first year, they should be able to produce 20% of what we need. The next year, 40% of what we need in a graduated process, we should be able. But I think it's important, and I think I drop my hat to the guys. Agriculture is important, and everything is available.
Yes.
It's just us and our policies.
Us, the people.
Yes.
But that's another concern, that the people that are in charge or at the helm of affairs do not give the opportunity or the platform to the people to practice it. Like the farming, they talk about farming equipment being absent.
Well, it's a complicated stuff, because it's at the level, the level at which it's been conceptualized, because if you give people, you know, cutlasses and you know, and stuff, it takes 6 days a week, a month to do something, which I know we had the tractors the last time. The way the tractors were managed, if you had put that tractor in a hand of like a commercial environment, in a commercial private environment, those tractors would have still been alive, because like we run our business, I've been on my business for 7 years. We've been running AfriCell for 11, 12 years. And so when something is in private sector and the level of focus, attention, discipline that is applied there is stronger, so you could sustain. Even, you know, if a generator goes down 12 o'clock, midnight, 2 a.m., yeah. there's somebody there who sends a text message that wakes up somebody. So the same discipline is not available in a governance, in a political arena. So I think that's, we need to work on that as a nation, from the political point of view, and all of us to know it's only when we start to do this in an industrial scale, in a commercial level. Mm-hmm. So where it takes a tractor to do a whole village, one tractor can plow for a whole village for the day, but it's how it's managed. And I think but we actually have to work on it.
Yeah, so now we have a surprise at
Arimah. One of our.
There's this girl, she loves you so very much.
Uh-huh.
She's been watching.
She's like really excited. She could not sleep.
Exactly.
She didn't sleep.
For the show.
For the show.
Yeah. Because she knows she was going to be in the
TV. She's
she's been
watching you on the TV.
Wow.
And she's like,
wow.
I want to meet with this man. And I'm sure you might have seen her on TV. She's quite a. Little girl, but
she's tiny.
And I know she's tiny. She doesn't like to be called tiny.
She's very smart.
You were talking about her mobile phone. You said the mobile phone would be bigger than her. which is not nice for you to say.
When she talks, she talks like somebody. You know, definitely know that she's the one talking, unless you see the face. And she has very important questions.
Bring her on board. But bring her on. Let's just get her question. What did she want to ask?
Anissa Nasu Kuyate.
Here
she comes.
Wow.
She looks beautiful, and she has the color
of the Afrisel purple. Are you an Afrisel queen or princess?
Hmm?
Are you an Afrisel queen or princess?
No, I'm not a big girl yet, so I'm surely a princess.
You know, you see what I was telling you about?
If I become a queen, I'll be tiny. But I'm not yet tiny, okay?
Look.
Alright.
Okay.
Good.
Okay, so Mr. Jabba is here now. We have a surprise for you. Mr. Jabba Spangwa is here.
Anissa.
Hold on. This is a dream.
Okay. Right? No, it's not a dream. It's not a dream.
Pinch me.
It's not a dream. I'm here. Okay. What's your question, Anissa?
Seriously, I've been longing to ask this question, but seriously, I'm trying to track you, but I wasn't able to, but now...
Mm-hmm. Okay, go.
Okay, so this question that I want to ask you, I've seen the designs that you have actually been making, designing the street.
You mean Afrisel?
Exactly, yeah.
Good.
Exactly at Wood Buffers Roundabout.
Okay.
I love that design very, very much. And so I want to ask you that this, when you became just a journalist here, was it just by chance or did you plan it for yourself?
What did I plan? What did we plan? The designs at the roundabout or my being here?
Yes.
Good. Well, I'm not even a journalist. I do a lot of things. I'm a bundle of resources and a bundle of tools. So I do a lot of things. In my stint in Afrisel, I've been in accounting. I used to be the chief financial officer in Afrisel, finance director, and then operations. I was the regional operations director for Southeast. So I was based in Bo, Kenema for quite a while, and rolling that. So that was in operations, nothing to do with accounting. But I've been involved in a lot of things in marketing and in HR and administration and you know, senior management since the start of the company.
Okay, so since you didn't actually plan it for yourself, did you have any other dream of being somebody else other than being helping
what
children?
What I'm doing, other than helping children?
Yeah.
You know, so do I have a dream at this stage? What would my dream be? Now, my only dream I would have is to be able to, like I said, I think it's following up from what I said just now. What I'd like to be able to do is to institutionalize this process of helping young people so that I don't have to be directly involved. People don't need to see me for me to be able to help them.
Yeah.
And so through the businesses and various things we're doing live by design, so there's a way of recording, registering people, preparing interventions for them, even the scholarships we're giving to be able to make sure you have a lot more people benefiting from the scholarship. So that's really would be my big dream. My biggest dream is to be able to institutionalize clearly been my biggest dream, to be able to institutionalize this process. So it's no longer me doing it, but I have people who will be doing it on my behalf. That's my biggest dream that I have for my life, to be able to help a lot more people without doing it directly by myself.
Okay, I think you guys catch that. But also, I'm expecting a scholarship for me from you.
A scholarship promise from you? All right, okay, Anisan. You got me there. So Anisan, you have a scholarship promise.
Yay! No, but she's smart, and then she outwitted him.
No, she did.
To give a scholarship.
No way!
You did?
No.
Okay. Your tiny self. I'm going to do your tiny self.
I'm not tiny.
You're tiny.
No, she's not. She's not tiny. I'm not tiny.
Just look at this.
She's a giant. Aren't you?
No. She's neither giant. Not now. She says she's not tiny.
I'm not a giant.
So you're tiny.
So you're
medium
what?
Sized.
Medium sized.
But it's not
okay.
Okay. Thank you so much, Anisan.
Thank you.
And it's
been all right, Anisan. Thank you very much. Just shake my hand so that you know it's still not a dream. It's real, and I'm here. So thank you.
Very much.
All right. Wow. My pleasure.
Okay.
Thank you. Bye, tiny.
My pleasure.
Okay. Now it's actually getting interesting. We're now going for the second news item. Now we go for our next item. Of course, awards are interestingly motivating, and this is a way to actually compliment people's efforts for what they've been doing for the past year or for the years round. Now, Masterpiece Foundation has just done that to actually compliment people's effort, especially young ones, by organizing the very first Nelson's Award, which was organized at the Miata Conference Hall in Freetown. Here are highlights of the event.
In commemoration of this year's International Peace Day, Masterpiece Foundation Sierra Leone organized the first annual National Nelson Award. The event took place at the Miata Conference Hall in Freetown on the 21st of September 2016. It was attended by so many young people and stakeholders. Among the 58 nominees, Brancita Krabo was crowned as the first Nelson of Sierra Leone. We caught up with him.
And yes, indeed, we have with us the Nelson for 2016. He won the Masterpiece for this year. Welcome to Wetin Now, and of course, congratulations.
Thank you.
Now, tell us about this award. What does this mean to you as a young person, getting this award and the first of its kind?
I think the award is telling me to do more. I think I've done a lot for youth and children in this country, and awarding me or recognizing me with this one speaks volume of some of the things that I've done, and that people, of course, align that excellence is recognized and awarded. So, excellence, this is it.
So were you expecting this, or did it come as a surprise?
Well, I was expecting it because I know I've done quite a lot. And even though I know there are a lot of people who have been doing similarly to what I've done in this country, okay. But I just believe that I will win. I know that, like I said, excellence is recognized and rewarded.
Hello, we have the very beautiful, amazing Phoebe Sweet, who was the chair. Good evening.
Good evening, Eric.
How was it like chairing this program, first of all?
Well, it felt good. I felt honored because we talk about how all of us can come together and participate, especially in issues that affect young people. And, you know, today is World Peace Day, and we've had the first Masterpiece Nelson Award in Sierra Leone. I felt honored that I am a young person and I was called to do it.
Hello, and now we have with us the country director of Masterpiece Foundation. He is Mr. Charles Boy. Good evening and welcome to Wetin Now.
Good evening.
I must confess, it's a very wonderful initiative, by the way.
Thank you.
So tell us about what brought about this initiative.
Oh, the initiative is International Nelson Initiative is directed at inspiring and recognizing young change makers in communities and the country as a whole. People who believe in the idea of Nelson Mandela to stand for a cause and contribute to society positively.
Okay, now we saw over 50 nominees for this Nelson Award. So what were some of the things that you looked into to qualify somebody to be the Nelson for this year?
58 nominees countrywide, and the judges looked at the age and your contribution to your society, your community. You should be a change agent before you become a nominee for the Nelson award.
And we are with one of the very amazing performers who performed extremely well today, and we were all tapping our feet. And of course, she's a brand new peace ambassador. Hello, Esther Michael.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good. I'm very well.
So basically, tell us about this award being crowned as the new SOX or peace ambassador. What does it mean?
It means huge. It's a lot for me. And it just tells me that there's a lot more to be done. And of course, we know music plays a lot of a really huge role when it comes to pushing peace and helping to have a stable society or community. And the truth is, music heals the mind, and where language cannot go or stands as a barrier, music has no barrier. I mean, you can listen to Chinese music, the African pop singers like Wizkid and the likes go across the continent to perform their own songs that even people in China don't understand. So music plays a very vital role when it comes to preaching peace. So this means that I, as a musician, have got a lot of work to do, ensuring that my music, preaches peace and helps build peace, especially among young people.
A play was staged to preach against violence. Who's gonna be crowned next? As we patiently wait for the next Nelson of Sierra Leone, this is Erikawa reporting.
Well, now let's take another item, the one of the very interesting segments. It is Pikin Wakabot. Ide Waka Olsai.
Pikin de Ide Waka.
Ide Waka, he puts the long, long. Let's see where he takes us this week.
Picking waka board, and the waka all side. Forget the news. When my family masuna can see, I did at the FBC College, and in at the oldest college in Sierra Leone and the biggest. And guys, now usa they so they talk to una. I did at the students hostels. And one thing where I don't notice from where I go around, one thing where I don't notice now that the road is very very scary. And I go over the girl, I go make me come around and show now the view at the top, but also outside is scary. Bambulem, as soon as I can see, we don't come on at the very scary road. Now we did not the David Cynical Hall. For una we no know, the David Cynical Hall, not the all the main hostels for the students there. But I walk around, I see say students, they know they live there because Bakuti don't bug there. Like taking for instance, the toilets first, they don't broke, the roofs they don't come on, a lot of things they don't come on. And then say renovation from the take place, but the Badia projects are not sure pay today. Wait there for doing the renovation. And yeah, so it's all like the college, na garage. Na garage is just take a look na garage, just look the rotten most cardio and park here. Like say this place na garage. Me na picking waka but
Mr. Bangura, as an inspiration to young people and as a motivational speaker, do you intend to go to schools to like motivate the children to realize their dreams, to realize their goals? most schools, like my school, we have career day talks where influential people, or maybe people that mean something in society, can come, and then they can inspire us with their life and what they've done, so that we can do as they've done, or maybe do more than what they've done. So would you in any way go to these schools if called upon?
Well, yeah, it's something I'd like to do, if it's planned very well. It's something I'd love to do. A couple of weeks back, I was out in Kano with World Vision. I serve in the board of World Vision Sierra Leone, as I'm the vice chair of the board. And so we were actually out in Kano. In places, Bongema, there's a place called Kenan, and there's another, I think, Koyema, I think. I hope that's what it was called. But we had the opportunity to be able to visit kids in school. And it was very exciting. You see, there's nothing I love to do more than be able to inspire young people. Okay. I knew who I was. I knew where I am now. And I know everything is possible in life. So to just look at those young people in their eyes and speak into them in a way that gets to their heart, that nobody should write you off. Neither should you write yourself off. You never. You saw my photos. I used to tell stories that you saw photos of who I was a couple of years back when I was a young man. And there's this movie, Mr. Ibu, where, you know, there's this scene where the guy had a wedding and Mr. Ibu didn't have anything to take for present. Yes, and he wrapped up the son. with a wedding gift wrap and took him in. So I used to say that even if somebody gave me to you as a gift, yeah, Nobody would take me. That's what I want. And so to just you know, think about that, and that I could be here today doing what I'm doing now, it means it's possible. The ability to become who I am now was always there, had always been there. It's like a seed. It's like a seed. The tree is in the seed. The ability to become who I am now was always there. It took nurturing. It took the environment, like a seed. If you leave a dry mango seed somewhere lying on a bottom mango, you know, by the street, cars would ride up on it. They would crush it. So that's my message to young people. That's what gives me the hope, the belief I have in young people, in the story of my life, and not just my life, in people that I've seen it happen practically. You're like a seed, so nurture. Providing nurture for young people is so important. Okay. The environment where they can be nurtured, somebody can influence them, like you're now doing on Wetin now. You're influencing people, you're telling them, you're giving them hope, you're giving them direction, a strategy, things to begin to aim at, people to emulate. And it's a nurture. That's the environment it requires to be able to take this seed and make it turn to a tree someday.
Okay, now, well, basically, before civilized. We end, just question.
No, I need to.
Yes, go ahead. Go ahead. So, once again,
I'm extending an invitation to you to come to your school.
What's your school?
Modern High School.
Modern High School. I've been there before.
Yes, but we need you to.
Were
come
you
back
there?
Again.
Were you there? Were you there when I went there?
What year did you?
3 years ago, maybe 3-4 years ago. I'm sure it was 2013, 2012. But I've been to Modern High School.
I don't think I've actually
been to Modern High School. But yeah, sure. You know, yes, have a deal. Let us plan it. But I'd like to be able to visit every school, every school in this country, to be able to look at the kids in their eyes and tell them it's possible.
Yes, indeed. So now, you spoke about a lot of things, a lot of success stories. Now let's take a look at some challenges. Mm-hmm. Tell us about some challenges. And another last question as a follow-up question. What, if you have the opportunity to eliminate one big challenge in your life, what could that be?
Now, so let's talk about challenges. You mean challenges for young people or challenges
in
for
your business generally?
Generally, the biggest challenge I have is the people challenge, in terms of looking to get the right people.
Okay.
Getting the right people are required in terms of their mindset, and not just in the skills. Because, you know, it's clearly, somebody says you hire for attitude,
yeah, mm-hmm,
and you can train for skill. So if you have people with the right attitude, they can always be trained. So having people have the right attitude, I think, is the biggest issue. That attitude to be able to learn and determine to learn what you don't learn. Discipline, coming to work on time, and integrity, don't take what's not yours, and just work in the straight and narrow. So it's, if I have a challenge, it's the biggest challenge ever, is the one that is the people challenge.
Okay, thank you so very much. It's been a wonderful time talking to you, and we're so, so delighted to have you in the studio. It's, I hope to have you in a subsequent edition.
It's a pleasure. It's a pleasure being here. And thank you so much for being a guest today in this live broadcast that was coming. This broadcast that was recorded at our AfriCell. I don't know. I'm just using this opportunity on behalf of AfriCell and possibly on behalf of the AfriCell subscribers all over the country, all over the nation.
And I'm one. Yay.
And you're one. And so this broadcast was actually recorded at our AfriCell headquarters, Wilberforce, live on Sunday, 23rd October. Thank you for also being a guest of AfriCell today. We're switching it now.
Okay, so that's it. That's all about we got for today. We want to say many thanks to the rest of the team. And of course, you know, we always talk about sponsors. Never mind, whatever way you want to assist us, you can come on board in different ways, with gadget, with money, whatever you have. We are still looking out for sponsorship. So many thanks to the rest of the production team, to the crew from AYV, of course, the AfriCell for welcoming us.
Yes,
many
for thanks. The beautiful place.
Very, very beautiful.
I'm so in love with it.
And please don't forget to vote for the award, as you know.
Vote. And it's only once in 24 hours. So yes. You only have to vote once.
Yes, AELA Awards. That's on Google. And what more can we say if not a very big and huge thank you to our own very producer, Mr. Baba Galesila, and to the rest of the Wetin Out team, for the reporters, everybody so far, thank you so much. It's been a very wonderful time, and many, many, many thanks. Until we come your way some other time, this has been Wetin Out, the basic info
you already know.
I'm Eric Kawa.
And I'm Arimah Bangura, saying goodbye.
Bye.